everybody. I'm Crystal Coney. I am here with the beautiful Tanee McCall Short, and we are in sunny California. We're about to get down to business talking about all things film related, from The End Again to whatever else we might get into. So, Tanee, first of all, let's just talk about the film.
Yeah.
I watched it. Amazing work.
Thank you.
So tell me sort of the story behind that and how you got involved.
Well, I'd known Crystal, the director, for some time. I think I met her during Stomp the Yard, the filming of that. And she said she had a short film and that she would send me the material, and she wanted to, you know, see if I identified with it or connected with it. And I read it, and I did. And so the next step was putting myself on tape for it. And so I put myself on tape, submitted it, and I don't know, a few days later, she was like, "You're the one."
So what about it made you identify with the character?
You know what I loved? I loved that I was in this weird stage in my career acting-wise where I was getting a lot of scripts, and they were either like baby mama roles, gold digger roles, stripper horror roles, or like slave roles. And, you know, there's that, but that was all I was getting. And when you would read it on the page, you could tell it was written for a person of color, mm-hmm. but like not necessarily written by a person of color. What you would think that we talk like or what we're like. And so what I loved about this is it was colorless. It could have been for anyone. And what I loved about it is that it read for, like, you know, what like a Caucasian actress would get to do. That it was just a story. And that the fact that it would have black faces behind that, I was like, amen. It was like almost like going back to the times of movies I grew up with, like Love Jones, like Love and Basketball, Poetic Justice, like very character-driven films, films with like a real story, patient films. And that's what connected me to it. It reminded me of like the old school, like 90 films, like Inkwell, all like Lorenz Tate, all that, you know what I mean? Jada Pinkett. Yeah,
so. You said that it was something about also a point in your life that you were going through, but I know that this film was shot before, you know, the big shebang that everyone talks about. So what was going on specifically that sort of really led you there?
As far as like with my relationship versus
that, or you just said when you read the script, it resonated with you, and you did say specifically the kind of character, but you said where you were in your life.
Yeah, I mean, we were separated. I was living somewhere else, but we were still in communication. We were talking, we were working towards a reconciliation. So it was really easy for me to connect to Jane because I too was going through the exact same thing. So, you know, my audition tape, I mean, the tears were real, the pain was real, the confusion, the doubt, the second guessing was authentic.
Right. So in the film, what I couldn't, it's a short, obviously, I couldn't figure out exactly why you guys were breaking up. Was that backstory there?
It wasn't, but like I made one up for myself. And so for me, you know, I was a working professional. I was, this is, you know, what I decided. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was ready for marriage and kids and, you know, responsibility and being serious. And here I'm with Joe, this artist who, you know, just wasn't maturing fast enough, who in my mind was kind of just playing video games, wasn't working, just got very complacent in life, and it was taking me for granted. And the warnings weren't working, the conversations and talks weren't working, and I had just kind of had enough and decided to that I needed to move in order to like start fresh. I wasn't able to be in the same city or state with him and not be with him. So I went the dramatic route and was ready to pursue a new life.
Now, is there something, or what was the most sort of poignant part of the film that, look, when you, I read that you didn't watch it right away.
I could not, no.
You watched it recently?
I watched it for the first time probably 2 weeks ago, two and a half, 3 weeks ago.
So
yeah.
What were you thinking? Tell me.
When I saw it?
Yeah.
I was like, oh my God, this is so good. Why? Like, I need to do something. I need to get in there. I had, I was friends with all of the producers, directors, writers on Facebook and Instagram, and they were doing an Indiegogo campaign to turn this into the full feature. The open-ended is the full feature. So this is the prequel. The End Again is the prequel to the feature film. And I said, you know, we need this. We being filmmakers, we being women, we being African Americans, we being people, like, people need to experience this film. So I called them and I said, you know, whatever you need to do to, you know, from me to help get behind this, because I, you know, I hadn't pushed it in any way, shape or form, and helped them during the time, you know, and they were completely understanding and completely knew why, and were being so very sensitive to the nature of the situation at whole. So I really appreciated that. And they were just like, timing is everything. It wasn't the time then. If it's the time now, let's do it. And so, you know, here I am, and I'm, you know, just getting the word out, because I'm really proud of the work, from the writing to the directing, the DP, the producing, the acting. You know, Columbus and I just feel like we did a really good job with it. And yeah, just wanted to get an awareness about it.
Okay, so you mentioned Columbus. A couple of things. You mentioned when you created the character, or when you created the backstory. Is that parallel to your life? You all's relationship?
No. Okay. No. It was just what I had decided. You know, we had done a lot of chemistry reads with a bunch of different actors, and through like three or four of them, and just having conversations with the actors, it was sort of what we came up together. Okay. It was interesting, actually. I didn't have that conversation with Columbus, though. Okay. Like, I don't know what his backstory was, okay. And I don't know if he knew what mine was. Okay. But you know, yeah, that was what the finished result was.
Okay, so now, is he on board for the following film?
I don't know. Yeah, it's you know, one step at a time. It's like getting the budget and the funding together for it first, and then, you know, the actors are almost like, yeah, that's like towards the end of it. It's like not an afterthought, of course, because it's important, but no, we haven't been assigned roles, or you know, we're just...
So he's not pushing it right now?
I really actually don't know.
Okay.
Okay. I would be lying if I were to give you an answer. I have no clue what his involvement.
No communication.
I don't. Yeah.
Okay.
The filmmakers might know. The publicist behind this might know, but I don't. Right. I don't know. Yeah.
When you watch the film, did it remind you of what you just went through, or what you're going through? Did that?
No, when I finally did watch it, I was ready to watch it, and I was ready to watch it for what it was and step back from it and not watch Tanee and not watch Columbus and not embed our stuff in it. I was literally watching Jane and Joe and watching a film, and, you know, we filmed it in January, so, you know, here we are in October. So, you know, you have all those months, 10 months later, I've separated myself enough from it to where I could enjoy it for what it was. I wouldn't push it forward like this if I was, you know, even maybe 3 months ago, I wouldn't have been ready to have the conversation. I'd be like,
yeah. It was beautiful work. I was watching it half asleep, and it kept me up. And I was watching the two characters as well, not you two. Let's just, so do you feel comfortable? Let's just say he does come on board, or you do here. Would you feel comfortable at this point doing press tours?
Oh, Crystal, that's a good question. You're giving me Oprah right now.
good, I
would
guess.
I be comfortable? I don't know. I think it needs more breath.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm good for right now, where I am right now in my space right now.
Okay.
But I don't know if I'm ready to stack more blocks on top of that right now.
Okay.
But you know, you never know what the future holds. I can't predict how my heart will feel later. But for right now, I don't think that would be a good idea. No, for my healing process. No. Yeah.
So how is that going, the healing process?
It's going really well. I'm so happy. Like, I'm so happy. I'm really appreciative for this time in my life. It's been such a time of growth, and that's not to say that I'm like, woohoo, if every moment's happy.
Right.
Like, you know, I definitely, it's, you know, moment to moment, but I love that I can own my moment, and it's mine, and, you know, I own my mistakes, I own my day, I own my choices, and it feels really great and interesting. You know, I met him when I was 21, so, you know, being, you know, now in my 30s and having a child, and, you know, not really, I haven't really experienced adult life,
alone.
Yeah. So I feel like almost like a time capsule. Like I'm 22 years old and like I'm trying to figure out Los Angeles and people and friends and, you know, I'm like a 40-year-old virgin. I feel I'm like so awkward. I'm literally stuck, like, I'm not an experienced, like, dater at all. Like, all my boyfriends were from school, and then I met Columbus working, and, you know, it's way different. Social media and the speed and technology, and, you know, also we live in LA. You guys are crazy. Men are, I'm not there yet.
You mentioned social media.
I mean, this is just my personal opinion. Mm-hmm. I don't think that a man just, like, you know, whoops up on a woman just one night and then never does it again and has never done it before. Like, there's patterns, and that's with, like, anything in life. People.